Hello, welcome back. In today's video, we're going to go over how to perform cash flow forecasts for an established business. First, we're going to take a look at sales because most cash flow forecasts start with sales, and we call that a sales-based approach. In this approach, the focus is on forecasting revenue. We will use our historic sales data to help us project into the future. Very important is to make adjustments for known changes in the economy or in demographics. For example, COVID-19 affects every business. So to do sales forecasts in this environment is absolutely indispensable to take that into account. The same thing is true for changes in demographics as the baby boomers age and also the millennium coming into the workforce and the Z generation. We want to take that into account on how they may affect the sales of your particular business. Once we have our sales forecast, then we turn our attention to cost. We separate costs into two big categories. The first are cost items that will typically be a fixed percentage of sales. Examples of this include cost of goods sold. In a restaurant, cost of food will typically vary with sales. And for these items, using the common size statements will be a very good starting point. The other type of cost items are ones that typically don't change with sales. An example would be lease payments or rent contract. The cost is based on the contract rather than sales. And a lot of this type of cost items will change with inflation rather than with sales. So we can estimate this cost item and then based on their historic value, we'll increase them by a fixed percentage. For the cost items that will change with sales, we will assume that the percentage will remain the same unless you have specific reason for why that will not be the case. In addition to cost, you also want to take into account planned major expenditures, especially equipment purchases, because those will also affect your cash flow. We'll have an example that will enable us to illustrate how to apply this sales-based approach. Before we go to the spreadsheet example, there are situations where you may not want to use the sales-based approach to estimate cash flows even for an established business. If this approach does not apply to your business, then you have no choice but to go back to the estimation approach that is item by item. The individual item approach is the same as a new business. So what that means is you have to identify every single item in the balance sheet and the income statement and then make assumption about them individually. Luckily, for most established business, we don't have to do that. We can take advantage of the historic trend and use the sales-based approach. Now we're going to turn to the spreadsheet template. If you have not done so, please pause the video and download the template, and we'll go over this exercise example together. Are we all ready? Let's get started. In the first page, it just gives you the legend, which indicated that blue highlighted cells are cells that you need to create formulas for, and pink highlighted cells are cells that contain information that is given. There is actually a lot of historic information that you're given for this business because it is established. So, for example, table 7.8 is the historic cash received and disbursements. So we can build our forecast based on historic information. Table 7.9 contains assumptions for some of the variables. So I encourage you again to pause this video and spend some time studying the assumptions. These are assumptions made by the owners based on their knowledge of the business. For example, they expect that cash sales is going to grow at a slower pace compared to credit card sales based on historic trends and what they have observed from the customers. The company also, their textbook gives you more background story about this company. The owner intentionally want to grow business sales. Business sales means that they are selling products to another business on credit typically. So they are creating accounts receivables. In terms of their purchase strategy, so this is part of their working capital management, they plan to use cash purchase a lot less. Cash purchases is going to grow at 3%, whereas they plan to buy on credit using accounts payable a lot more. Purchases on accounts payable is going to grow at 10%. They also estimate that their hourly employee wage is going to grow at 12.5%. This is a unique assumption because they are expecting that there may be substantial changes in the minimum wage either in their local state or maybe even nationally. Whereas management salary, they expect that will increase closer to the cost of living or inflation, which is 3%. In the long run. Table 7.10 contains other assumptions, and you'll notice that this assumption is relatively straightforward. Most of the fixed cost is expected to increase by 3%. There are the four items that are different is FICA. FICA is a federally mandated tax, so that is going to be 7.65% of total wages and salary. Workman's comp is expected to be 80 cents per dollar per year, and credit card is estimated to be $50 flat fee per month plus 3.8% of sales on credit card. And for rent, they expect no change. So these are the assumptions that was given, and we're going to implement that these assumptions in forecasting cash flow for this company. We'll start with table 7.11. This is an example of using just 2 months to demonstrate this process of creating a cash flow forecast. Later on, we'll apply the same technique to do a full year forecast in table 12. So let's get started. We remember that the important assumptions are located in table 7.9 and 7.10. In the real world, it's very common for you to be working with spreadsheets that have multiple pages. And it is very convenient if you can see those pages side by side. And we're going to do that here. One of the options on the menu is View. And you can choose to open up a new window. Back to View again, you can choose to arrange the windows. And we'll just use the default. So here we have two windows of the same worksheet side by side. You can check that by looking at the top to make sure that it is the same file. And now I can move the tab on one of these windows. I'm going to move to table 7.9 on the left window. So here we have the key variables, and it is easy for us to see. On the right-hand side is the spreadsheet that I'm creating the formulas for. The forecast for this year is equal to the sales level of last year times 1 plus the rate of increase that we expect to happen. The first row is cash sales, and the rate of increase for cash sales is 4%. To create this formula, make sure that I'm clicking or active on the correct window. You should always check to make sure that your cursor is on the active window before you start your formula. Right now, none of the cell is highlighted, so if I start the formula now by pressing the equal sign, it will not work properly. If I click on this cell, you notice that it is active. Now I press equal sign, and I'll start the formula correctly. So this is very important if you are new to Excel to always watch for whether or not your cell is active. So I start the formula by picking up the percent last year's sales, so that is $1,008 times one plus, and here this is the rate of increase. So that is in table 7.9. In here. So by having the cells side by side, it makes it much easier for me to navigate. We know that it's going to be the same percentage increase for every single month. So I can make that an absolute reference by pressing F4. Now to finish the formula, I close the parenthesis and press Enter. We'll do the same for credit card sales. Again, make sure that your sale is active. Start with equal to last month's or last year's credit card sales times parenthesis 1 plus. Credit card sales is going to grow at 5%, which is located in cell C6. Make that absolute reference by pressing F4 and close parenthesis. So we do the same for the next one. So you will see the formula that I'm entering. So again, you can work along with me and pause the video at any point you need to. So now I have completed forecasting cash receipts. The total cash receipt is simply the sum of the three areas. Next is cash disbursement. We know that cash purchase is going to grow at 3%, but purchase on credit, which is accounts payable, will grow by 10%. So we'll do that. Okay, so let's go ahead and work on purchases. So these are the cash disbursements, cash on delivery. So this is purchase where you have to pay cash on delivery. And that's going to increase by only 3%. Whereas the next is payment purchases that allow you to pay using accounts payable, and we hope that that will increase by 10%. Here is hourly employee wages. Even though the base number is zero, we'll still enter the formula because we want to make sure that the formulas will work regardless of the circumstances. So we'll do the same thing. And the hourly employee is expected to increase at 12.5%. Whereas the managers, the rate of increase is only 3%. Here we're going to create a subtotal for wages and salary. And the reason is because the next field calculation, FICA and workman's comp, is based on the combined total. So again, we are creating formulas that will work regardless of what the underlying numbers are. Now the remaining variables, the assumptions are located in table 710. So we're going to move to table 710 on the left hand side. Now if you have many tabs, it may not all be showing. So if you see the dot, you click on it, that will open up the next set of windows. So here we will go on to table 710. The first one is FICA, and we know that FICA is 7.65% of total wages and salary. So that's equal to, so that is not a percentage of sales, which means that it's not going to increase based on historic trends, but rather is computed based on wages. So the formula will start with wages times 7.65%, so it's relatively straightforward. Again, we want to make sure that we use absolute reference by using F4. Workman's comp, again, we need to read this description carefully, is 86 cents per dollar. So that means if you have 49.44, we multiply that by 80 cents, but it's per year. So let's start with taking wages and salary and multiply that by 80 cents. Again, we're going to make that an absolute reference. And then because this is per year and we are computing just for 1 month, we're going to divide that by 12. Next, we have advertising. And here you may want to change the width of the column. So each time you move the window, you first tap on the window. And if you make the column narrower, it will allow you to see more things on one screen. And later on, you can make this wider again as you need to. So here we can see advertising is going to increase by 3%. So we take last year's advertising times 1 plus 3%. Again, we're going to make that an absolute reference. Credit card, we saw in here that credit card is $50 plus 3.8% of credit card sales. So we'll have to translate this contract into a formula. Make sure that we are on the right cell. We start with equal. So we have $50, that's our base. Again, make sure we make that an absolute reference. Plus is 3.8%. So again, make that an absolute reference. Multiplied by credit card sales. And credit card sales in this case is $529. And rent, we know that rent is going to be no change. So it's just the same as the last year. For the remaining items, we notice that they are all increasing by a fixed percentage. We do not use a single number for all these items because we want to allow for the flexibility and the option that perhaps some of these items may increase at a different rate than others, especially when you're doing scenario analysis. So when you're creating an assumption, you want to think ahead. Could it be in a scenario where perhaps electricity may increase at a different rate than repair and maintenance? It is entirely possible that repair and maintenance may go up higher, or that gas for trucks and equipment may be lower because gasoline prices is lower. So when you create the assumption, make sure that you create the assumption with maximum flexibility. The next thing that I want to look at and observe is that the order of the assumption is the same order as in the model. And that creates an opportunity for us to enter the formula in a more efficient way. We do need to make the reference to the assumption area an absolute reference. And if we do that, we cannot just copy it down. However, we can create the formula first using a relative reference, and then we convert that to an absolute reference. So it's just a matter of finding the most efficient way to create your formulas. I want to emphasize that that is not required. I'm showing you many different ways to create formulas because you will be using this a lot in your work. So I'm showing you options. So go ahead. I'm going to go ahead now and show you how you can create the formulas using relative reference and then go back in and change them into absolute reference. The first item is insurance, is equal to last year's insurance times 1 plus the expected increase. I'm not going to turn that into an absolute reference yet. And now I can copy this. And to paste the copy value to here, I'm going to use Control V. So you want to go double check to make sure that the formula is as you wish. So this is C11. We double check that C11 is for water, and you can spot check. Repair and maintenance is C15. And yes, repair and maintenance is C15. So if we are satisfied that the formulas are entered correctly, now we're going to go back and make that into an absolute reference. To do that, you can do one of two ways. One is you can click on the formula and then go up to the formula tab and click on the cell and then press F4 and then press enter. You can also use the arrow key instead of the mouse. I have used the mouse for 1 minute too many in my life, and it is much easier for me to navigate using the arrow key. So if you ever get to the point where you find that using the mouse is painful, you will want to learn how to use the arrow key. So using the arrow key, you can move to the cell that you want to adjust. You can press F2. That will open up the cell formula, and then you can use the arrow key to go to the cell that you want to edit. In this case, my cursor is in the correct cell, and I just press F4 and I press enter and do the same thing and it is very quick. So once you get used to it, then you'll find that using the arrow key is a much faster way. So again, I just press F2 and then F4, enter, and the cell has been updated. So now I can go back to check to make sure that I didn't miss any. I did miss one, so make sure that all of them are set correctly. And you're looking at the formula bar here. So you scroll back up one every cell to make sure that all of them are now in absolute reference. Okay. The next item is total cash disbursement. That is to sum. So we just need to add up the cell above. Be very careful because you want to include, you don't want to double count total wages and salary. So if you include the total item here, so that is your sum. So again, focus on the formula up here. I included everything, but I still need purchases. So I'll add cash purchase and also accounts receivable purchase. So when you design your model, you should know what your model represents. So be very careful. And then your net cash flow, this one is easy, is equal to your cash receipt minus your disbursement. Again, I refer to the textbook for this particular company. It's a very seasonal business, so during January, it's not surprising for us to see negative cash flow. Once you have completed the formulas for January, and if you have completed it correctly, you should be able to just copy it all to June. So we highlight everything in January, press Ctrl C to copy, and then move your cursor to June, and then press Ctrl V to copy it down. And notice that it's not showing the correct number. That is because the column is too narrow. You can double-click that to expand the column, and that will give you, it will show display all the variables. This completes table 7.11. I will stop the video here. In the next video, I'll continue with the remaining tables. See you soon.